Vi er taget ud til Carlsberg, og anledningen er, at Cees 't Hart stopper som CEO for Carlsberg efter godt 8 år. Han har sagt ja til at bruge en tid sammen med os og de private investorer for at sætte fokus på hans lederskab og Carlsbergs udvikling. Så velkommen indenfor. Cees 't Hart, thank you so much for having me here and inviting for the private investors to have a chat with you.
Very welcome.
These are the last days, so to speak, in your professional career in Carlsberg. What is it like?
Different. Yeah, it's another 8 days to go. Not that I'm counting them down, but that's just a fact. Of course, I knew this moment was coming. And in that respect, it's a bit of a double feeling. Of course, sad to go after 8 wonderful years. On the other hand, looking forward to a new era, hopefully longer. I will go home after 8 years because I was commuting for 8 years between the Netherlands and Denmark.
So no more commuting, at least.
No, that's for now.
You brought, or your colleagues brought us this beer, and to all the viewers out there, it's non-alcoholic. So maybe we should taste it.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm keen to do that.
Yeah, so it's not every day that I drink beers in the working hours.
Oh, it is an alcohol-free beer. You can have this
for
breakfast, for lunch, for dinner.
Skål. So, if we take off with that category, non-alcoholic beers, I guess a lot has happened during the last year, 8 years since you came in.
Well, yeah, has nothing to do with me, but the category took off. I think we saw it in time. In 2015, we decided to invest in this category, and at that moment of time, it was known but not known for its great quality. And only in Spain it was already relatively big. And then we started with indeed launching many of our brands in alcohol-free, with, in my view, really excellent brews. And that has led now to, let's say, in most of the countries, a segment of 4-5%. And I think over time it will double.
Double is maybe where it comes.
10% right there. And that's not without any data behind it, because Spain, as I said, launched it a bit earlier, and they are now around 12-13% of the total category is alcohol-free beer.
If we look at that category, do you see any other categories in the future that your successor will have to develop? Are there any other categories coming in that you can, so to speak, make more money of in future as well?
Yeah, there are a few, but I'm not going to tell you that because
close the camera.
Competitor is listening.
Okay.
But the category of beyond beer is something where I think also in SAIL 27 we have articulated the opportunities, and I think there will be an opportunity for growth.
Okay. Yeah. So and I guess that from a SharePointer's perspective, the earnings on actually that category are quite good.
There's two things, of course. First of all, we don't need to pay excise on this, so we have more or less the same price, so we make a bit more margin. Yeah. On the other hand, it's a more expensive brew. You need to brew it in such a way that the consumer has a feel that they still are very close to a real beer. And by that, the production cost is a bit higher. On the other hand, it is enlarging the beer market because more consumers come into the beer market because they like to drink a beer, but not sometimes with alcohol, and driving is not a good good combination, and therefore they're doing this. So we see more moments for this category.
Sounds good. If we just have a quick look at the nowadays, so to speak, you just delivered your last half year report. From what I could see, some analysts were a bit disappointed, but still, from my perspective, you actually did far better than 2022. What's your own words on the first 6 months for Carlsberg?
We put it in the announcement. It's a solid result. We did better than we expected in the beginning. You've seen that. We had a tremendous number of risks in the beginning. COVID in China at the beginning of this year, we were not clear whether the Chinese New Year would yes or no be impacted by COVID. We had, of course, I still have, unfortunately, the war in Ukraine. And if a missile, unfortunately, would would hit a brewery, we have three. That would mean, of course, disruption in our business. So this business continuity risks. And then at that moment of time, we knew that we needed to raise pricing in Europe, Western Europe. And the risk was that there that the retailers would not immediately absorb, allow us to absorb the cost increase. So these were the risks. Therefore, we guided -5 to +5. Yeah. And now we basically reduced the range and upgraded towards 3 to 7%.
So you're satisfied with the solid result for the first half year, at least?
Yeah, and I think where a few remarks came from was Asia, and especially China. And within China, then our premium brands. And I think when we explained to some of our analysts and especially investors, they looked at ABI that came in with very good growth in China for the first half year with premium brands. Mm. However, they had not realized that the first half year last year was extremely bad for them in the east of China. So Shanghai was, as a city, was closed for six, seven weeks. So they could barely sell any volume, and then it's of course easier. We will have that in the second half of the year, where the COVID was more in the western part hitting cities and areas where we are. So we think we have a very good second half of the year in terms of premium brands.
So you leave the company, so to speak, in an okay place.
I hope it's a bit more than better than okay.
I'm from Jutland, so
But I'm a Dutch Calvinist, so I can relate to these kind of words. Okay. I think we're in a good place.
Yeah, but looking from the outside, some of the it seems to me like the analysts are not always agreeing on looking at Carlsberg. Some are raising your targets, and some are saying, sell. And do you think it's difficult in general for the investors and the analysts to look from the outside into your business?
Yeah, but if you look at that for all the others, they're in the same place.
Yeah.
So as you know, the work of an analyst is to look at companies. He cannot have all the companies he follows on buy or hold or sell, so he or she needs to make a choice in that. I think by and large we have not moved. Well, we have moved significantly since 2015, because there are many analysts that put us on sell these days. These days is more on buy or hold. Only a few on sell. And frankly, if you read these reports, they are very much at the bear side. And sometimes, so let me put it this way: some analysts understand this better than the others.
Okay, that was the question, the answer I was looking for. But looking back at 2015, when you arrived, what was the temperature like, and were there anything that surprised you when you sort of arrived here in Carlsberg?
Yeah, there's many things, but basically always at the moment that you come new in a company, things surprise you, because basically you cannot discover everything in a due diligence or when you come from outside in. I'm very sure that Jacob, who comes here in 9-10 days, also will see things that surprise him. That doesn't mean necessarily it's good or bad, but it's different than one can expect. At that moment of time, we had a profit warning August 2015, and that's of course that surprised me and the market, and that is a bad place to start. But it was what it was. Yeah.
Did you come with that profit warning? As I can't remember what happened in the days.
You? At the moment the profit that you expect is less than what we promised, then there's a profit warning. I didn't do the promise, but I had to do, because the promise you do at the beginning of the year, and sometimes you don't know how a year unfolds, so that was unfortunate. Yeah.
The first thing you had to do.
Yeah.
But what then, when you were looking at the company, what was the sort of the main task for you? What was the thing that you had to succeed on when you learned the company to?
Well, we had a round with investors before I let's say reported on a quarter, so it was a kind of informal talk, a bit like this, and they all gave a bit of feedback in terms of what they expected from the company in the future. And out of that, we said that we should increase our margin, reduce our debt, And you can only do that by increasing your cash generation, of course. Yeah. And then, of course, the investors hoped for improving dividend, and at a certain moment, share buybacks if we would not be able to do acquisitions. So the capital allocation, I think, we made more clear those days, and started to deliver on these. Frankly, these are all very, if you like, financial KPIs. Yeah. We also looked at ourselves on organizational and strategic, and later on societal health of the company, in order to have a holistic approach of the company.
Yeah. So that was many different paths that you had to go. But some of it actually came in dialogue with the investors that you actually tried to.
Yeah, dialogue. They were Jutlandish or Dutch in their clarity, or they wanted that. The share price those days, I think, was it the 3rd of September? It was 508 Danish crowns. So it was relatively low at that moment of time, and it was losing vis-a-vis the others. Mm-hmm. So in this kind of cases, it's all relative. So how do you perform relative to the other brewers? And we were not in a good place at that moment of time.
So you had to work hard at the time with your team, I guess. You, it seems to me like you're working as a leader dedicated with the strategy, in the sense that the sales strategy, did it come from yourself, the idea of the sales strategy? Or?
Yeah, you have the strategy and you have the name. Huh? So the strategy we co-created. So I think it's important that, and especially for me those days, because I came from Unilever and then from dairy. So I had worked in many, many categories, I think, in terms of the, let's say, more than 20, 25 categories, from deodorants to margarine to milk to yogurts and so on and so forth. But I didn't know anything about beer. So to come in and to say, look, I'm here a few months and this is what we're going to do, is not a good recipe for success. We involved, or I involved those days, the functional leaders and the country leaders of Carlsberg. Together we came to a kind of analysis where we were at that moment of time and also the plan for the future. Mm-hmm. And then it was my proposal to really brand it as a strategy, because if you say, well, our strategy is, it's a bit less engaging than you talk about a journey, about where you want to sail to, who you have on the boat, what the keel of the boat is, and so on and so forth. So the metaphor helps people to understand the strategy.
Yeah, which I mean, even for us as investors, I've attended the general assemblies, and it seems to be the story that you keep us as investors as well telling us.
And the nice thing is, if you would travel around, you see everywhere in Carlsberg, whether you're in China or Malaysia or Switzerland or Norway or here, you see the picture of the sailing boat and also the articulation of what are we thriving for.
How long does it take if there is a recipe for a new CEO to get into a company? Is it's not, as you say, 3 months is maybe not always the time. Maybe it's more a year or 2 years to get grab of the company. Is it
depends on how the company is organized. And those days, I must say, it was a different philosophy. It's not about good or bad, but the philosophy was that all the countries more or less did their work on their own. And then at the end of the day, it should lead to a result. Okay. And we came from more kind of, this is what we want to do. And you as a country, or you as a function, you need to basically contribute.
Follow
us and contribute. Yeah. So it was a bit of a different approach. And at the end of the day, that worked well.
So it took,
and then it takes a bit more time.
Yeah, it took a bit longer than one should expect, maybe for your successor, so to speak. When you leave the company today, hopefully it will not take as long.
But hopefully not. And he starts in a slightly different way than I started. Over the last 3-4 months, he got already all the documents. He got a special person to support him in, if you like, educating him in FMCG, in beer. In the way we run the company, and of course at a certain moment is his freedom to change things.
From an investor's point of view, we have seen that that the share price has grown quite significantly, which is, I mean, we need to pay respect to that. Do you think that if you hadn't experienced the two crises, the current the COVID crisis and the Ukraine crisis, that you could have done even better as a CEO with the company?
Well, we would have been further in our journey for sure. Whether that would have translated into a higher share price, you never know.
That's right.
Not related with each other. But yes, I can give you an example. The penetration of alcohol-free beers would have probably been deeper, so we would have been further. The number of countries with blanc would have been higher at this moment of time. Because the last 3 years, because of COVID, then the Russian crisis, and then the huge inflation, it was all hands on deck to run the current company. And at the moment that you need to take 10 to 15% price increases in most places in Western Europe, you can't ask them to do on top of that all kinds of extended commercial actions. So it's first things first. So probably we would have been a bit further.
A bit further. The last part of this is just to get your voice on maybe the greatest risk and challenges for Carlsberg, or maybe the industry in the next 5 to 10 years. How do you see risks or challenges for the industry?
For the industry, I think in the past it was very clear. Some were brewers and the others were in carbonated soft drinks, and the other were, or others were maybe in lemonades and these kind of things, or energy drinks, and the distinction blurs, and that's an opportunity and a threat. The opportunity is that suddenly the size of the pie is significantly bigger. On the other hand, others might also look at our territories, where I think what is extremely important in our kind of business is to be number one or number two in a country. So your route to market and the strength of that, that is determining your success in the future.
And that maybe leads to my last question. If one is a private investor out there, and we have a few of them, looking into breweries, what should they look for?
Let us do it.
Okay, drink the beers.
Drink the beers.
instead of don't, buying the
don't
shares.
Don't compete with us. Oh, no, okay. Yeah, buying the shares, sure. Okay. But you're talking about private...
Not opening breweries, but more what should one look at as maybe the key figures or the, you know, how can we evaluate Carlsberg and other breweries? What is important?
Ah, okay. Well, first of all, the clarity of the strategy, the professionalism of management, and then see whether the strategy and then the subsequent half years, maybe not a quarter because a quarter, but half years and then the full year, if that is really moving into the direction of what I promised.
Yeah.
But for that, strong brands, that's where it starts. Strong operations, so being the number one and number two in the market, but also, of course, is it a bit of a mix of consolidated market and growth markets?
Well, let that be an advice for all the investors out there, and thanks for this first...
Well, there's only... we can combine it all. It's buy Carlsberg shares.
Buy Carlsberg shares, yeah. But this is not a, this is not what we're here for. But thanks a lot for your time, and we will be back with a talk also on the, as I call it, life as the CEO during the 8 years. So, but thanks, Kes, for having us.
You're very welcome. Thank you. And cheers.
Cheers.
Skål.